now it takes more than a robin to make the weather go. And it takes two lips of fire to melt away the snow.
But it takes two hearts of cooking to make a fire grow. And baby, you've got what it takes.
Welcome to Albany Tempo Spectrum. I'm your host, Donald the Soul Man Hyman. And April is Jazz Appreciation Month, and we celebrated with the Smithsonian Museum in Washington, D.C. All throughout the country, people are celebrating April is Jazz Appreciation Month. And this month on our show, we're celebrating our third season with Kalpas Quartet. We're going to have an interview with Tom Pierce. And a surprise. We're going to find out about the surprise later. But let me tell you a little bit about Tom Pierce. Tom Pierce has been a supporter of the Capital Region Jazz community, and he's been sharing his love of jazz and supporting musicians. He has websites including allaboutjazz.com and albanyjazz.com and the Yahoo group Songbirds, the singers of classic pop and jazz. He's worked with WBGO, one of my favorite stations down in Newark, New Jersey. And he's been involved with jazz organizations here in the Capital Region, like the Swingtime Jazz Society. And he's been, which he was a board member, a publicist, an event coordinator, and a consultant on requests from 2006 to 2010. And he received an award from the Schenectady as a Schenectady Jazz New York Jazz Hero. Mr. Pierce, who's from the Bronx originally, says he has about 3,000. Recordings, videos, books, and magazines. Wow. Ooh. And he's going to be honored April 19 at the Colony Elks by the Albany Musicians Union. And that's as a part of Jazz Appreciation Month. That's on Sunday, April 19th at the Colony Elks. The Albany Musicians Union will be celebrating Jazz Appreciation Month. And they're going to be honoring Tom Pierce, as well as some other people here in the community. So without further ado, Daddy-O, 23 Skidoo, and we'll come back to you. Here, let's take it away, Mr. Pierce. Mr. Pierce, how are you today? Welcome to Albany Tempo Spectrum, and we know that you're a jazz connoisseur, like myself and some other folks out there, and this is a show for connoisseurs. So one of the questions we'd like to ask you, and our audience would probably like to ask you here on Albany Tempo Spectrum is, why are jazz festivals like the Albany Riverfront Jazz Festival and SPAC that we have here in the Capital Region important for maintaining jazz?
They provide a platform to pull in a lot of folks who are not passionate jazz fans, folks who may not want to spend money on a cover charge to go to a jazz club, but are curious about it and would like to see it in a relaxed setting that is free and open. And a particular thing I always try to point out, and it's important to get the young people aware of jazz and not feel that it's your grandfather's music, is that they get an opportunity to see some younger people playing it, that it isn't just music by old people or dead people. It's music that is very vibrant. Mm-hmm. It's played with a lot of passion and energy by people their age, people that are in their 20s and 30s, as well as the older musicians who are wonderful, of course, in their 40s and 50s. So that's just another reason why I think the festivals are very important. They provide a setting that's very attractive to bring in other than just the passionate hardcore jazz fans.
Yeah, because I remember running into you at a couple of the Albany Riverfront Jazz Festivals, and it was like the crowd, when they got there that morning, they didn't leave. They stayed until like 7, 8 o'clock till the fireworks were on. But what I felt was that having you there and other people who are like jazz impresarios in the area, make it possible for us to keep the preservation of jazz going, especially in the Capital Region. And since you mentioned young people, how has jazz influenced contemporary music such as rock and roll and hip-hop?
Absolutely. Well, these forms of music like hip-hop and rock and roll and R&B or rhythm and blues come from some of the same roots mm-hmm. that jazz came from.
For example,
going all the way back. Well, one key part of music that affects both hip hop and rock and roll is a term. I'll use a term that was coined in 1948 by a fellow named Jerry Wexler, who was with Billboard then. It was rhythm and blues, mm-hmm. or R&B, and it's basically black music. He worked for Billboard, and they had their music charts for country and western and jazz and pop. And one of them, they used to call it race music, or actually Harlem Hit Parade was mm-hmm. the polished term that they used. Right. And Jerry Wexler, who's a tremendous producer, worked with Atlantic Records, and he knew a great deal about jazz and other forms of music, mm-hmm. was to capture the spirit and the essence of black music. And this goes back decades. It goes back into the days of the boogie-woogie and jump music, people like Louis Jordan. And that type of black music, which was essentially dance music, mm-hmm. Which was entertainment. Sometimes when people think of jazz, they think of it more as an intellectual art form. And a lot of that was because of bebop, which was a wonderful part of music that people like Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker developed in the 40s. But we use terms like jazz, R&B, bebop, etc. But rock and roll came out of rhythm and blues, came out of black music. Mm-hmm. But it was also melded in with country and western music mm-hmm. and pop music. Mm-hmm. Jazz itself used many other types of music. Broadway show music. The pop music that we call a Great American Songbook mm-hmm. were the songs that people like Duke Ellington and Miles Davis, well, not so much Duke Ellington, because Duke wrote his own material, but Miles Davis and Coltrane, before they started developing some of their own music, they did a lot of music that was originally in Broadway shows and in the movies. So the point I'm trying to emphasize is while we use specific terms to encapsulate music, they all go back a long way. Now, specifically with rock and roll and R&B, and to a large extent, hip-hop, the rhythmic aspects of jazz, which comes from Africa, mm-hmm. ultimately, is probably the biggest gift, if you will, that they took out of it. The hip-hop people also love the melodies, the riffs, the vamps, the clusters of notes and chords mm-hmm. that are in many jazz songs. And these hip-hop artists, which a lot of people aren't aware of, are very knowledgeable jazz fans. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of these jazz songs that they sample and they use bits and pieces mm-hmm. in their hip-hop are songs that necessarily weren't big hit records for jazz artists. But they know these jazz artists, and a lot of them are not just the people like Miles and Coltrane and Dizzy Gillespie. They're lesser known people, but they listen to hundreds of these and they pick out pieces that resonate with them. So that's another gift that hip-hop gets from jazz, just as rock and roll gets it from R&B. To say someone like Louis Jordan, the wonderful saxophone mm-hmm. player and singer, well, was he R&B? Was he jazz? A lot of this music is melded together. It isn't, and because what we're talking about is an expressive form, whether you want to call it art or entertainment. So musicians, and a number of musicians, they don't like the term jazz. In fact, they don't like any of these terms, quite frankly, because they look at it from the perspective of themselves as an individual musician creating music, mm-hmm. being influenced by another musician creating music. Mm-hmm. So when people are sitting home and writing up music, or woodshedding as they call it, they don't think, well, gee, I'm going to do some jazz, I'm going to do some hard bop. And these are all great terms, you know, and this is music that I personally love, the various forms, and we have to, because we're human beings, this is how we try to get our arms around various types of music. We give them terms, descriptors, but the music comes from a number of different sources. And hopefully I've indicated how the current music is influenced by jazz. And it's really, lastly, I'll say, it's almost impossible for anyone, even people who say they hate jazz, not to be influenced by it, because jazz is all around us. Yeah. If you go to the movies, if you watch TV, you're going to you listen to the radio. Mm-hmm. You're going to hear jazz in the commercials, if nothing else. Even though you don't listen to a quote-unquote jazz song, the commercials have jazz backgrounds. The movie themes have jazz backgrounds, and that's the way it's been. And there are jazz musicians playing these, jazz composers, I'm sure you're familiar with, who've done a lot of composing for films that had nothing to do with music and certainly nothing to do with jazz.
You mentioned something about rock and roll, and it's very important because a lot of people don't see the connection. But like you said about Louis Jordan, mm-hmm. one of the clearest indicators of how directly you descended is most rock and roll songs, the fast ones in the 50s, mm-hmm. all retain the what kind of instrument? The saxophone.
Absolutely.
There's always a little saxophone solo in the Yakety Yak or Charlie Brown. Mm-hmm. There's a saxophone piece coming in at some point in those 2-minute records. So it's a direct descendant, and you mentioned the fact it's dance music coming out of that whole 20s and Harlem and the dance clubs and
absolutely.
That type of thing.
Very absolutely. Important. No, it's that's very true. When I was a teenager, mm-hmm. back many years ago.
And you're from the Bronx?
I'm from the Bronx, but I used to get on the train early in the morning when I was 13 or 14 years old and travel to Brooklyn.
Uh-oh,
to the
uh-oh.
Brooklyn Paramount for Alan Freed's rock and roll
now
shows.
Now you're talking.
Alan Freed's rock and roll shows, when you mentioned saxophonists, mm-hmm. he had people like Sam the Man Taylor, mm-hmm. Big Al Sears, Georgie All, King Curtis.
Yes.
So that type of rock and roll, which was melded with another form of rhythmic black music called doo-wop, mm-hmm. The saxophone was very big. Now the guitar was also very big. Mm-hmm. The saxophone, which many people look at, if you say, well, draw an instrument that sort of symbolizes jazz. If you really thought about it, and I've done a lot of work on this for presentations, the tenor saxophone is probably the instrument mm-hmm. that is sort of associated with jazz. But obviously, the pianists, the vibists, the bass players, the guitarists are all extremely important mm-hmm. to jazz. And if you're going to have a big band, you need all of these pieces, right. all these sections.
If we're going to have a fantasy concert, I'm going to throw some names out first.
Sure.
And the first word that comes into your mind when I throw them out, just give me what you feel. Dinah Washington.
It's a toss up between bluesy and sassy.
Dinah.
She was married 6 times.
Oh, she was sassy? Okay. Here we go. Billie Holiday.
Mournful. Yeah.
Mournful.
To me. Now, she was a lot of things. Mm-hmm. Obviously, no one word can describe any one person.
Mm-hmm.
She was the most expressive jazz singer I've ever heard. And I've listened to almost all of them, I would like to think.
And unlike the other girls that had heartbreak songs from this, Sarah Ellen, she was writing stuff.
She was expressing them in a way I've listened to, and I've not only the songs, but also interviews, and I have many female vocalist friends in New York and up here, and Billy is the one singer who they relate to on a totally different level than all the rest. Mm-hmm. He just comes across the most convincing.
Mm-hmm. She was there. She lived it. Miles Davis.
Well, the word I guess I think of initially is cool. He could be very hot when he was talking to you if he was angry, and he could play with a lot of fire. But it was just something cool about the way he did things.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
He was just an absolutely master musician and master band leader, mm-hmm. even though he did it in a very unique way.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's throw some pianists in here since you mentioned piano. How about Ahmad Jamal? Who I just recently saw with the egg with the Japanese young lady.
I've seen him live many times in a number of different cities. Mm-hmm. I guess the word exquisite to me would be the term that would come to mind.
Okay, and now the pièce de résistance. Okay, Jean Coltrane.
Powerful.
Powerful.
Yeah.
Great.
Now, not powerful necessarily in an angry way. Mm-hmm. He played with a lot of feeling. I love Coltrane for his ballads more mm-hmm. than anything, even though the up-tempo tunes are what he's more associated with. His ballads, like the album he did with the great Johnny Hartman, is absolutely timeless and absolutely memorable.
What I would like to do is, I'm going to give you a fantasy concert, and out of those folks that I just mentioned, who would you like to have perform at that? Let's say they came to SPAC or Riverfront Jazz Festival, who would you pick to be the headliner?
Well, if I could only have one as the headliner,
only one.
It would have to be, for me, because he's my favorite musician, it would have to be John Coltrane. Okay. But it would be John Coltrane up to and including A Love Supreme. Mm,
okay.
Not the material he did after that. Not that it was bad, but it was a style that I didn't relate to as well. But Coltrane, he was just unique. He was the most dedicated. His wife said he would sleep with his saxophone. and he was just very special.
Interesting. Okay, well, welcome, and we thank you so much for coming to Albany Tempo Spectrum and giving us your perspective on jazz, because we know April is Jazz Month and Jazz Appreciation Month, and we're celebrating it in the nation, but especially right here in the Capital Region. And we have Mr. Tom Pierce here, who is a jazz connoisseur. And I use that word very, very lightly, because I know he's more than a jazz connoisseur. He's also a writer and an artist. And an individual who told me from the very beginning, he's a fan of jazz. He just loves jazz. So if you love jazz, Tom Pierce is the person you should get to. And we're going to give them information on your website.
Yes, vocaltraditions.com has a great deal of information about all the activities I've done, but even more importantly, those artists and the types of music that have moved me the most over the last 60 years. I'm not ashamed to admit that I'm 73 years old, and I've been into music since I was 12 or 13. But the music that I love, which is not only jazz but other types, is described there, and people are free to go and look at it.
Okay, thank you for coming by, Tom. And you're welcome to come back to Albany Tempo Spectrum. You're officially a part of the family. We have a way of closing that's very special. It's peace and chicken grease. Ready? On the count of three. Peace and chicken grease. On the count of three. One, two, three.
Peace and chicken grease.
We'll see you. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.